Good evening. Welcome to Alice Waters Talk, How to Cook an All-Vegan Thanksgiving. No. Welcome. I'm Mark Checklebain. I'm the Community Relations Officer for the Berkeley Lab, and you're not at All-Vegan Thanksgiving Talk. First of all, before we start, I wanted to ask, because there's a lot of new faces I see tonight, if folks, I have two colleagues here with some forms, could fill out our Friends of Science brochure and our questionnaire. A, because there's a lot of new folks here tonight, we want to hear how you heard about it, and B, we don't have our schedule up yet for our next talk, so we want to be able to email you that series. So you guys could, if you could raise hands of those of you that aren't signed up for Friends of Science, so we can get you on our list and hear more. Thank you so much. My name is Mark Checklebain, as I said, and I'm the Community Relations Officer for the Berkeley Lab. And I thank you for your interest in scientific research being done at the lab, especially those of you who've not been here before. How many people haven't been here before? I'm just curious. Wow, that's great. We're really glad you're here. First, we want to thank our co-sponsors, UC Berkeley, the Chabot Space and Science Center, the Exploratorium, the Osher Lifelong Learning Institute at Berkeley, the Lawrence Hall of Science, and the science departments of Albany, Berkeley, and Oakland High Schools.
Okay. So thank you all very much for coming out tonight, and I hope you'll enjoy yourselves. So the title of my talk is deliberately a bit unusual and provocative to draw you all here, Dark Energy Rules the Universe and Why the Dinosaurs Don't. And in the last couple of weeks, I've had a number of people particularly interested in how I'm possibly going to work dinosaurs into the expansion of the universe and dark energy that fills it. So you'll find out about that. So to begin with, let's start with what's right underneath our feet here in Berkeley. As we walk around Berkeley, we see the beautiful views, you see the bay, you see the hills rising up behind us. And as you walk up those steep hills, you may well wonder, why am I walking up these steep hills? Why are these steep hills here? And so this is the view from Berkeley Lab, looking out over the bay toward the Golden Gate. And we can ask ourselves, what's the process? What's the science behind landforms, behind the bay being there, behind the hills being there? And so as we ask that, let me get the pointer out. And so as we ask how that happens, we are led into scientific investigations. And so what causes the formation of hills, of mountains, for example? And so we now have a very good theory for that, the theory of plate tectonics, that continents move around on the surface of the Earth on very long geological timescales, hundreds of millions of years timescales. But then we can continue to ask why. We can continue to wonder, well, what is causing them to move around, to float around on the surface of the Earth like that? And that then leads us to understanding of where does the heat in the Earth comes from. And you may think that this is old heat, that this is heat left over from the formation of the planets. And that's what people thought in the 19th century, but that's not in fact the right answer, as they quickly realized you would not have enough heat left to do that. It's in fact new heat, heat that is generated in the core of the Earth and is continued to be generated today from the radioactive decay of atoms in the Earth. And so what's causing the steep hills is, in a very real sense, one of the fundamental forces of physics. We can also ask, well, why don't we have very tall mountains? Why are the hills sort of rounded? Why have they been eroded? And we're then led to all sorts of considerations of meteorology and weather, rain, wind, processes, and so forth, that are gradually beating down the mountains that are being built up. And so that all of the energy in the Earth system of the climate, the winds, and so forth, is all driven by solar energy. And so we're led to understand our sun as a star and what causes the sun to give the energy. And so this immediately then leads us to the process of fusion, how atoms can combine together, hydrogen can combine together to form helium, releasing energy, the fusion process, which relies on the strong force of physics. And so we saw here, didn't quite mean to do that yet. So here we were talking about the radioactive decay, the weak nuclear force, and here we're talking about the strong nuclear force. And so we immediately have two fundamental forces of nature, just as we understand how Berkeley comes to look the way it does. But then if we ask, where did the atoms in the Earth that are giving off this heat come from? Where did the atoms in the sun or the sun itself come from? Then we are led out into the universe further and further, led toward the idea of star formation. How do stars form in the universe? And then if we go back a little bit further and a little bit deeper in the universe, how do galaxies form, assemblages of stars form in the universe? And so the simple everyday questions lead us out into the universe. It's like the Taoist saying that the journey of 1,000 miles begins under your feet. As you walk around Berkeley looking under your feet, wondering why are things the way they are, we're immediately led out into the universe. And we're led as well to the fundamental understanding of science, of physics, that the four fundamental forces in physics are the things that are making the world the way we see around us. We can also ask not only how things are, how things are in the current state, but we can ask about the evolution of things. We can ask, how do things divide up over time? And there again we see that there's no division, there's no sharp line between the questions that we ask about the human world, the world that we see every day, and the fundamental forces of nature and the fundamental properties of the universe as a whole. And so here, if you ask, well, how did we come to be? How did life evolve on Earth? Then we have to understand biology. We have to understand genetics and molecular chemistry. We have to understand DNA, for example. Well, how do things change? We know that we're built up over DNA, but how do you get the diversity of life that we see on the Earth? Well, you have a process of natural selection, but you need an engine to drive the change, and that's mutations in the genetic code. And what causes these mutations are high-energy particles that strike the Earth from outer space called cosmic rays. And these cosmic rays gradually, again, over geologic time, will induce mutations in the DNA that then gets selected by the evolutionary process. And you get an evolution of life. You get a diversity of life. And I always like this picture because it looks like one of these mutating cosmic rays is hitting directly on Berkeley. So I don't know if that means anything. But we can ask then, well, what's causing these very high energy particles, these cosmic rays? And these are accelerated to their very high energies by massive explosions in the universe, stellar explosions called supernovae. And so this is an example of a supernova explosion. This was called supernova 1987A. We first saw it in 1987. It's a relatively nearby supernova. But particles are accelerated in these sort of explosions to form cosmic rays. We can also ask about life on Earth on larger scales. So here's the first tie to the dinosaurs. So you go back 100 million years, the surface of the Earth was, of course, inhabited by dinosaurs of all sorts. And you can ask, why aren't they here anymore? What happened in the evolutionary process such that there aren't dinosaurs around anymore? And so, as I'll talk about later, the leading theory for this is the impact theory, that, again, something from outside the Earth, the universe influenced the Earth through an asteroid colliding with the Earth, creating a vast cloud of dust that blocked out the sun for months at a time, lowered the temperature, putting a great stress on all of the ecosystems. And the dinosaurs could not survive under these conditions. But again, you can continue to ask why. Right? It's like your two-year-old child, right? And whenever you answer a question, they then have to ask why. Well, scientists like that. Scientists want to hold on to that curiosity about nature. And so we can ask, well, why was there this impact? What caused that sudden change? And then you have to go out into the dynamics of the solar system and understand, how do bodies orbit in the solar system? How do you perturb an object from that orbit so that it then comes crashing in toward the Earth? And you have to understand, how does the solar system form? What other objects are there out there? And then again, you're led out into the universe. You're led into stars and the galaxy and the universe as a whole. But again, the main point I want to make is that there is no division between the everyday things and the most fundamental questions of nature, the most fundamental questions of the universe. Everything is dynamic on all scales, from the molecular and atomic scales that you're talking about to the large scales, the big creatures walking around, to the universe itself. And I'm sure you've heard that the universe as a whole is expanding. It is dynamic in time. So I want to show a very brief movie talking about what we, how we understand this, the stretching of the universe, this expansion of the universe, and yet how the objects within that expansion can go their own way. So here's a movie. You see the overall expansion, but you also see that objects within the expansion are clumping together under gravity. And so this is a simulation done by a professor in the astronomy department here, Chung Pei Ma, and this is a solution of the equations of how things behave under gravity. And let's see if I can play the movie again. Okay, so again, you have this large-scale expansion, but within the expansion, gravity is bringing together material to form galaxies and stars and so forth. One of the things that you realize when you're doing astronomy, when you're looking out into the universe, is that astronomy is really a time machine, that you're seeing things as they were in the distant past. And the further and further out that you look, the more and more you're looking in the past. And this sounds like a paradoxical concept, it sounds like a very unusual concept, but it's really something that, again, you know about from everyday life. If a friend goes away on vacation and sends you postcards, and I don't know if anyone still does, they just send you emails, but this analogy works much better for postcards than for emails. So they're off on vacation and they send you postcards, then you know that you don't actually know how is your friend doing at that moment that you're reading the postcard. You're getting a snapshot of them from the past. They're telling you, oh, we're in Florence or something and we're having a great time eating gelato, but you know they're not eating gelato right then. They were eating gelato a few days ago. And as they go further and further away, the postcards take longer and longer to reach you, and you're looking further and further into the past of their lives, of their vacation. And so the same thing happens for astronomers. We don't know what the conditions at great distances right at that instant, but we can see them as they were in the past. And the reason is not because of the mail service being slow in the universe, but that the speed of light is, it's not slow, it's very, very fast, but it's not infinite. It has a finite speed, and so it takes time for those signals to reach the astronomers, to reach us through the telescopes. And the more distance the light has to travel, the longer it takes. And so you're seeing things longer and longer ago. So again, looking out in the universe is looking back into the early history of the universe. So this is a very good thing because we can learn a lot about the way the universe was in the distant past, and we can understand how did things come to be the way they are today. So again, the analogy I want to draw is to something more familiar to all of us. Suppose we want to know about global warming. Suppose we want to understand what was the climate history of the Earth like? What was it like 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago? If we want to understand, is the temperature actually warmer today, we have to know what it was in the past. So there are many techniques for doing this. The one that I'm showing here is looking at tree rings. And so we can look at tree ring growth, and that tells us about the environment of the tree. And so by seeing is the tree ring narrow or is it broad, it tells us something about the conditions in the past that tree experienced. Was it a wet year? Was it a cold year? Things like that. Astronomers want to use exactly the same principles to understand the conditions of the universe and how the universe expanded. And so we want to look back into the past. To do that, we need some very bright objects. We need to be able to see them to great distances to sort of map out the conditions in the universe. And again, those exploding stars that I talked about that gave you the cosmic rays, that gave you the mutations, that gave you the dynamics, the evolution of life on the Earth, those supernovae are just about the brightest single objects in the universe that we can really use as ways to map out the universe to its most distant reaches. And so the idea is we want to look at supernovae at different distances in the universe, and we want to understand how the expansion is happening. Is the expansion slowing down? Is it speeding up? And so forth. And that will tell us about the cosmic environment of the universe, of how it's expanding, in just the same way that we can learn about the climate environment through the tree rings. So again, we're trying to basically map out the history of the universe in this way. So we want to look back 10 billion years. Here's a picture looking back 10 billion years. So this was taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. Okay. And it's a marvelous picture. Scientists just spend days and days and days studying this picture, staring at it, just really loving the beauty of it. So there are some objects which you can clearly recognize as things that look like galaxies that you've seen in picture books that we see in the nearby universe. But what you have to realize is all these tiny dots here, all these faint little dots, those are galaxies also. Those are the galaxies that are even further away, even fainter, even smaller. That's looking back 10 billion years rather than our neighbor galaxies. So basically every point of light that you see here is in itself a galaxy just like the Milky Way galaxy that we live in. Not quite just like the Milky Way, because again, we're seeing it as it was 10 billion years ago, not as it is today. So here's a movie from, let me actually see if I can go back. Let me go back. No, all right, then we'll let the movie go. So here's a portion of that Hubble Deep Field. That was a supernova going off in the Hubble Deep Field. And now again, you're zooming out, you're seeing all the galaxies. You're zooming out even more, seeing the night sky, the stars, and so forth. Okay. And you can see that again, you're led to things that are very familiar. And so that supernova, which was the most distant supernova we've ever seen, that occurred in that Hubble Space Telescope view, okay, that occurred 10 billion years ago. I'll play it again okay, so there's the supernova going off in one tiny, tiny part of the Hubble Deep Field, which as you see is really a very, very tiny part of the entire sky that you can see. And so again, it shows that as we study one particular object, we're trying to learn one particular physics thing, it's really connected to the everyday things that you know around. As you go out tonight, and if it weren't cloudy tonight, you looked up in the night sky and you would see some familiar stars, you can think that, yes, there's a supernova going off in some galaxy that's 10 billion light years away. So let me talk a little bit more about supernova. It's not as simple as simply going out and staring up in the night sky and seeing what happens. There's a lot of technology that goes behind it, a lot of very hard work, and a lot of computation. So I've got a sort of montage of pictures here. I'm talking about some of the instruments that people at Berkeley have built and are using to find these supernova, both the nearby ones to understand them and the most distant ones. And so, for example, there's the Kate telescope that's used by people on the Cal campus. And there's a SNF spectrograph, which is a particular type of instrument to understand the composition of the supernova, what elements make up the supernova, that again was built by people here. And the Kate telescope is just down in the South Bay. The SNF spectrograph is at the Mauna Kea Observatory on top of a mountain in Hawaii. And fortunately, our poor grad students don't have to go all the way out to Hawaii every time we want to observe a supernova. We can keep them nice close at home here. And so in the basement of one of the rooms, one of the buildings up at LBL, we can have our graduate students and postdocs pretending that they're in Hawaii and observing the supernovae this way. So again, one of the great things about Berkeley Lab and Cal is how the undergraduates, the graduate students, and the postdocs can really dive right into the cutting edge research and make the discoveries and analyze the data and really come to understand what is going on with the science. So let's see, and then here's a mosaic of a small fraction of the supernova that have been found in these sort of searches. And then a lot of the effort is actually the computational effort. Again, the supernova is a bright flash. It happens and it's gone. And you've got, in order to understand it, you really have to remove all the other objects in the sky, basically, from your calculations to understand just that one supernova. And so it takes a massive amount of computing. And again, we're very fortunate here in Berkeley that we have a supercomputer center up the hill. And so here's the NERSC, the National Energy Resources Supercomputing Center, and that is again used by a lot of the people, including the graduate students and the postdocs, to understand the supernovae. So how do you actually use the supernovae? How do we actually learn about the universe? Again, it seems It seems like hubris to think that we can understand the universe even by observing these objects that are so far away. And in fact, there were times that people despaired and made prognostications that science would just hit a wall, would come to an end, and that you just could never learn anything more. And so here's a philosopher from the early 19th century saying we shall never be able to know the composition of stars. And the great thing about these prognostications that science will just hit a wall and that you just won't ever be able to learn anything else is that they fail so spectacularly and they fail so quickly. And so it was only 14 years after he said that in fact physicists came up with a way to understand the composition of stars. And so a physicist called Kirchhoff understood the electromagnetic spectrum, the visible light, the infrared light, the ultraviolet light, and so forth, and discovered that the particular pattern of dark and bright spots within that spectrum encodes the composition. It tells you what elements make that up. And again, this is something that you know about from everyday life because you go to the supermarket. And maybe you don't know what's in the can. If for some reason you couldn't read what's on the can or the label was torn off, you could still understand what's in the can. Certainly the checkout machine knows exactly what's in the can because it reads the barcode. And that barcode, that pattern of lines, says exactly what's in the can, it says exactly how much it costs, and so on and so forth. And that's exactly what Kirchhoff discovered in the electromagnetic spectrum. So if we take a spectrum of our own sun, then again, here's the visible part of the spectrum. We have from the red through to the violet. There will be a pattern of bright spots and dark lines. And those tell you exactly what elements make up the sun. We can do the same experiment here in the laboratory, and we can see, okay, that element has that pattern of lines. So we basically have an inventory of all these barcodes that we build up in the laboratory, and then we look out in the universe, and we can use that same inventory to understand what makes up all the objects in the universe. And so we can disprove this naysaying that people had, that we can never know things, by always coming up with cleverer ways of doing this. To go even further back in history, when we want to try to understand something, suppose you were handed a gold crown by your king, and your king said, I want to know, is this pure gold? You know, how can I possibly tell if that's gold, if that's solid gold all the way through, or if someone was trying to pull a fast one and either mix some other metals in it, or maybe it was hollow or something like that? So I'm sure this is a pretty familiar story to most of you, that this was done far, far back in the past by Archimedes, where he had his eureka moment. He had his scientific breakthrough and understood how he could figure out if this was made of pure gold without cutting the crown open. The king would not look very kindly on cutting it open to see, oh, it's hollow or oh, it's solid. Okay? What he realized is the displacement of water tells you something about the internal nature of the object. Okay? You can learn about the composition by studying it in this scientific way. And so these eureka moments are things that scientists look for. I mean, that's what really makes your career, having this idea of how to discover something when everyone said, no, science just hits a wall. You just have no way of being able to go further and figure out the nature of something. And so I want to talk about a few eureka moments from Berkeley Lab and how this eventually ties in with the supernovae and the expansion of the universe. So let's go back to how do you figure out what's inside an object. Instead of a gold crown, let's take a really big object. Let's take a pyramid in Egypt. And let's find out, is there treasure hidden in it? Maybe gold treasure, maybe archaeological treasure, and understanding the culture and the history of Egypt. And so the idea is, how can we look inside the pyramid without taking it apart stone by stone? And so Luis Alvarez, who led a research group at Berkeley Lab for many, many decades, and eventually won the Nobel Prize in Physics, was renowned for having these incredibly clever ideas of how to do something, often based on everyday experience, and figure out how to understand science in that way. And so going back to these cosmic rays, remember the things that caused the mutations in the DNA and landed on Berkeley and all of that, these cosmic rays are going through the Earth all the time. So if you put a detector at the base of the pyramid, underneath the pyramid, you could ask, well, how many of them get absorbed in the pyramid? Is the number that get absorbed the number that you would predict if you had a solid stone object, or if there is some secret hollow chamber in there, then fewer will get absorbed because they're not absorbed as they pass through the air of the chamber. And so Luis Alvarez went to Egypt and tried this, and in fact found that there were no secret compartments in the Great Pyramid here. And this has been used by archaeologists ever since then, in fact. It's continuing to be used. I saw a news article about using it on Mayan pyramids just a month or so ago. And so this was sort of a eureka moment that Luis Alvarez had. And so now if we go forward a few years, his son was a scientist also, a geologist, also at Berkeley. And he got a gift, a paperweight rock, at one point that his son had brought back from Walter Alvarez had brought back from Italy. And the rock had this particular layer in it, very well-defined layer in it, that was very high in the element of iridium. And it was kind of a curiosity, and it was kind of a puzzle also. Why was iridium so high in that one particular layer? And you can geologically date the layers in such a way that you could tell it dated back to 65 million years ago. So again, iridium is kind of strange because there isn't actually a lot of iridium on the Earth. Most of the iridium, things that are rich in iridium, are sort of left over from when the solar system formed, when the planets condensed together, and so forth. And it's much more common in asteroids than on the Earth. And so that started them thinking, where did this iridium come from? And what's special about this 65 million years? And of course, they realized it was a very interesting date because this is the boundary between two major periods in the Earth's history, in particular how species evolved on the Earth, that there's certain sharp dividing lines where, for example, the dinosaurs go extinct and the mammals start coming forward. So this is called the boundary between the Cretaceous and the Tertiary. The shorthand for it is the KT boundary. And so maybe this had something to do with the death of dinosaurs. So they decided, well, let's think about this some more and let's bring in some other experts from Berkeley Lab. And so they put together this team of people, I mean, not in a formal way, just, you know, people who would talk this over. And it's an excellent way of how science is done because it draws on people from different disciplines. So Luis Alvarez was a physicist. He was a particle physicist, but he also would go off and figure out things like, are there secret chambers in pyramids? Walter Alvarez was a geologist. You had chemists involved in this as well, people who studied nuclear physics and so forth. And so these people would follow up on this connection with the iridium. And they asked, well, how does the iridium abundance go as a function of time as you look in these geological layers? And you see there's this spike at 65 million years ago, that there was a lot more iridium suddenly 65 million years ago than before or afterward. But again, iridium comes from stuff left over from when the solar system was formed. It comes from things that are now in asteroids, for example. And so they put this together, and it's a very long story that I won't go into because, again, I'm talking about supernova and the expansion of the universe. But the idea is that an asteroid could have impacted on the Earth, a rather large one, about 10 kilometers across. In the years since then, they've actually found the impact crater off the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. And this is now the most generally accepted theory for what caused the extinction of the dinosaurs. And so, again, it all came from this paperweight rock. And then you put a lot of great scientists together and you come up with some very interesting things. But you can keep asking why. Remember, you're never supposed to stop wondering. You're always supposed to be like that two-year-old and ask why. So why did the meteorite hit us? Why did the asteroid hit us? Was this just a random event, a one-off thing? If you look at the fossil record, then in fact extinctions seem to occur fairly periodically. And so you basically map the number of species on the Earth as a function of time, and you see that the number of species, actually the number of families of species, seem to have a particular periodicity to it. That it's not that there's a continual extinction, but there are particular peaks to it. And you can do some statistical analysis and you can pull out this 26 million year period. And so now you say, well, why every 26 million years? So Rich Muller, who you heard at the last Science at the Theater talk, talking about physics for future presidents. So in the 1980s, he was a member of Luis Alvarez's group, and he was very interested in this. And he came up with the hypothesis that you have a perturbation. You have something that's kicking these asteroids into the Earth. That basically, every 26 million years, there can be another object, a very massive object, in fact, another star, that passes close enough to the solar system that it disturbs the vast reservoir of comets that are way out beyond Pluto. And they'll go into the inner solar system, and some of them will end up hitting the Earth. So every 26 million years, you have this rain of asteroids, and one of them may end up hitting the Earth. So he invented this companion star explanation called Nemesis. So here's Rich as he looked in slightly younger days. And again, the idea is you have this swarm of comets way out there that we know that comets come from the very outer solar system. And that occasionally, as Nemesis goes around on its orbit, it will perturb these gravitationally. They'll start to fall in, and some of them may then hit the Earth. So the obvious thing to do was to go out and look for Nemesis. And so his student at the time, Sol Perlmutter, decided that for his PhD thesis, to get his doctorate, he would automate one of the telescopes here at Berkeley, at Leuschner Observatory, just up in the foothills, to look for Nemesis. So it would scan the sky over and over again, looking for anything that changed, that moved, the way a star that would be orbiting around our solar system would be, to look for these changes. So here's Sol in younger days, and here's the Leuschner, the telescope at the Leuschner Observatory just up in the foothills. So the end of the story is we know that this was a time when a great Eureka idea didn't actually pan out. The extinction of the dinosaurs is indeed caused by an impactor, but there is no Nemesis star that anyone has ever found. Okay? We don't know what causes this 26 million year periodicity. People are still coming up with ideas for that. But this was still a very successful idea. Just because you don't find Nemesis, you don't get your PhD thesis taken away from you. Okay? You still get to go forward. And he was extremely successful in another topic that no one was thinking about at the time. So again, he's doing this automated search looking for this Nemesis object, this change in the sky, what's moving in the sky, what's changing brightness in the sky. And he didn't find a nearby star, but that's exactly the type of search that you want to do to look for these stellar explosions, these flashes, these supernovae. And so basically, they invented an automated supernova search. And as you heard in the introduction, this is the thing that 10 years ago gave you the really big Eureka moment. And I'll get to that in a moment, what happened in 1998. But let me just run through this chain of logic again. Again, to get the point across that science is something creative. It's an art in itself. It's not something where you say, okay, you know, I'm a research and development company and you're supposed to look at this specific topic and only this and get that result, okay? The wonderful thing about being at Cal, being at Berkeley Lab, is that you have the freedom to let your curiosity take you wherever it seems fruitful to go in. And so we started off trying to find hidden chambers and pyramids with Luis Alvarez. His geologist son, Walter Alvarez, then gives him a rock with a peculiar mineral layer. You're led to extinctions of the dinosaurs, periodicities. You start looking out into the universe, what causes this periodicity of asteroids. You add in a bit of technology, you improve the telescopes, improve the detectors, automate the searches, and you end up finding a lot of supernovae. And so then in 1998, you had enough supernova, you were able to look far enough out into the universe that you made this amazing discovery. The universe is expanding, we've known that for 80 years. But this expansion is not slowing down the way you would think under gravity. It's speeding up. It's accelerating. And so the way you should think of this picture is, again, a simple everyday way. You're throwing a ball up in the air. And so you're standing here on the ground. You're going to throw a ball up in the air, and you're going to look at the path of that ball. And so each of these curves, think of the path of a ball as you throw it with a different impulse to it. So you throw a ball up in the air, you know very well what's going to happen. It's going to slow down, reach a peak, and come back to Earth. And that's exactly what we expected to happen from the universe, that the universe is expanding, but it should be slowing, slowing, slowing. Sometimes you throw the ball hard enough that it goes into orbit. You probably actually need a rocket for that, but still, it goes into orbit, it doesn't come back to Earth. Or if you have a bigger rocket, it escapes from orbit around the Earth, and it will go off to the moon or out in the solar system or wherever you like. OK, Okay, it depends on how hard it's thrown, but it's still slowing down the whole time. It's still getting further away, but gravity is still trying to pull it back to Earth. So it's still slowing down all the way. Gravity will always slow it down. It's always attractive. And yet, when you plot the paths of these balls, it should always lie in this gold region. You should always slow it down. But when you plot what the supernova told you, when you map the history of the universe from these sort of postcards that the supernova are sending you as you look back in the universe, you find it lies in the blue region, which is the region where it accelerates. And so this was the amazing discovery that showed there's got to be something other than gravity, or there's got to be something we just don't understand about gravity at all, because it's not slowing down, it's speeding up. And this little poster that was put together to explain this discovery is actually on the wall of the Office of the President Science Advisor in Washington. And we always like the sort of subtext to this, that we talked about the gold region and the blue region, and it's, of course, the Cal colors. So there was this amazing discovery, the acceleration. But what does this mean? What does this tell us about the physics? So there were, in fact, two supernova groups, both of which had good representation from Berkeley, the group at Berkeley Lab and a group, the high redshift team that had a number of people from campus, that independently discovered this expansion, independently were doing these supernova searches, and found that the expansion was speeding up. But again, we have that puzzle. So what is counteracting gravity? So Einstein is, of course, the great authority on gravity. He was named person of the century and so forth. And then here you've got science calling it a breakthrough of the year, this discovery of the accelerating universe, and you can see Einstein's looking pretty puzzled, trying to figure out, well, what went wrong with my beautiful theory of explaining gravity and explaining the expansion of the universe? And he might have thought other things. But physicists as a whole, this was really a revolution to them. And the last 10 years, the revolution has continued, where they're saying, you know, we just have to answer this question. There's something we fundamentally don't understand about the forces of nature until we can figure out why is the expansion speeding up. So to start to understand how you can get around this, let's go to Einstein, but let's go to the most basic thing that Einstein said. Okay, so you've all heard of E equals mc squared, and I'll lead you through how we can start to understand this just by understanding this equation. So what Einstein said is that when you weigh something, when you ask what the gravitational attraction of something is, you care about the mass, but you care about everything that looks like mass, everything that contributes to the mass. And what E equals mc squared says is that energy, any form of energy, contributes to the mass. It contributes to the gravitation. So all the energy has to be taken into account. And so the kinetic energy, the internal particles moving around rapidly contributes. That creates a pressure. That contributes to the energy. But if you are not only including the mass, but you're including these other forms of energy, doesn't that just add even further to the gravity? Doesn't that make the problem even worse? So the way you can think of around that is, suppose the pressure were negative. Then when you add it to the mass, it's taking a little bit away from the gravity. That's effectively an anti-gravity. If you could come up with something that had negative pressure, you would be getting negative gravity. You'd be getting negative mass. So let's see, is this just a completely crazy idea, or does it make some sense, this negative pressure? So when something expands, usually it cools down. And so the experiment that we can all do here now is we have air in our lungs. It's more or less at body temperature. If we expel it from our lungs, then we can measure its temperature. So if you didn't bring a thermometer with you, well, you did bring a thermometer with you. Your fingertips are very good temperature sensors. Okay? And so if you breathe on your fingertips, keeping your mouth open so the air is not expanding very much, then you feel warmth, right? The warmth of your body temperature. But if you purse your lips so the air expands as it leaves your body, then you feel much cooler. The air feels much cooler. As it expands, it cools down. So the same thing is happening with the universe. As the universe expands, it is cooling down. And that corresponds to a situation with positive pressure. I won't go into exactly why. But we do know of objects that behave the opposite way. And so a spring or a rubber band And you probably didn't all bring rubber bands tonight, but you can do this experiment when you get home. So again, we want to take the temperature of the rubber band. So doing it with your fingertips is a little awkward because you're holding it, so it's hard to measure it at the same time that you're holding it. So you have another temperature sensor that's even more sensitive than your fingertips, your lips. And so you take the temperature of the rubber band by touching it to your lips, and it feels fairly cool. And now you expand it, you stretch it suddenly, and touch it to your lips. And you should be able to detect that the temperature rises. So we expand something, and the temperature doesn't cool the way it did with the air coming from your body, but it increases. It gets hotter. And that's effectively a negative pressure, that you have to do work to expand it, whereas the air wants to escape from your body when you breathe out. And so there are situations that effectively have negative pressure. When you suck a drink through a straw, that's also, you're creating a negative pressure. You're drawing the liquid toward you, for example. So it's not a strange exotic physics thing, or it is a strange exotic physics thing, but there are situations, again, in the everyday world that things happen the same way. So you might ask, well, does that mean I can create anti-gravity just by stretching rubber bands? And the answer is, well, unfortunately not, because it's just such a tiny effect for rubber bands or for anything that we can make here on Earth, but it is possible. And so the idea is, if you had a big, big rubber sheet covering the whole universe, and one of the things that Einstein said is that space-time itself, the curvature of space-time itself, is gravity, that's all gravity is, the curvature of space-time. Basically, like you had a huge rubber sheet, you drop a bowling ball in this rubber sheet, it creates curvature. A marble will then roll toward the bowling ball, not because there's any force, but because it's following the curvature. And that's all that gravity is. Gravity is an illusionary force caused by the curvature of space-time. Not really illusionary, it's just an equivalent way of looking at it. And so that's the normal thing that happens, that you drop a bowling ball on the rubber sheet, and you get this curvature, you get this positive pressure. But suppose you could make the bowling ball out of negative pressure stuff, stuff that had so much negative pressure that it overwhelmed the mass and it made the whole mass go negative, the whole gravitational force go negative. Now you drop the bowling ball on the rubber sheet and instead you get a big hill. And now when you roll a marble along, it gets repelled. It's not going to be attracted the way it would normally for gravity, but it won't run away from it. And that is the basic idea behind accelerating the expansion of the universe. And the really amazing thing about the discovery in 1998 is that this was not some incredibly exotic phenomenon that you can only do in the laboratory under very high pressures or in huge particle accelerators or something like that. It's something that is making up almost 3/4 of the whole energy in the universe, acting in this really bizarre anti-gravitational way, this negative mass way. But again, it gave this challenge to physics, fundamentally new physics, and we need to understand what's going on. And so when you do the measurements carefully, you can ask exactly how much of this strange material is there relative to the stuff with the positive mass there is in the universe. And so you have this sort of cosmic pie chart, and again, it's very humbling to realize that the stuff that makes up us, the normal elements that we know about on the periodic table, is less than 5% of the type of stuff that there is in the universe. There's other stuff called dark matter, which is still positive under gravity. It still acts normally under gravity. We haven't yet found it yet. We have a lot of hopes that within the next 3 or 5 years, we actually will be able to find it in the laboratory. But then there's this weird negative mass stuff, this anti-gravitational stuff, causing the acceleration, which again is about 70% of the universe, and it's given the name of dark energy, just because we have no idea what it is, and if we just kept calling it the new stuff, then it would confuse people. So when you put it all together, the stuff we're used to that we explain in the textbooks is only 5% of the whole universe. And so there's a lot of work to do, and so this is how we encourage undergraduates and graduate students to join our groups. We say, look, you've got 95% of the universe to discover. You know, some of you have got to get a Nobel Prize out of that. So, but of course, it's stuff that I hope is also very interesting to you to understand what's going on. So what we mean by dark energy, we mean that it's 70% or more of the entire energy of the universe, that it accelerates the expansion. It acts in this anti-gravitational way. And because it really dominates and it acts so differently than the normal gravity, it's going to determine what the fate of the universe is. Just like when we threw the ball up in the air, suppose that ball actually had a rocket strapped to it so that as it started to come back to Earth, we could turn on the rocket and it would go away again. So the fate of that ball, does it come back to the Earth or does it go off to infinity, depends on the nature of that rocket that you strapped on, how powerful it is. In the same way, the fate of the universe depends on that. But when I wrote these down, I said, you know, that's exciting to me, but, you know, is it really going to be, am I going to get the excitement across? So I decided, no, you can't really say it that way. That you've got to say it this way. You've got to put those exclamation points in. And so the way I try to describe it is this is triple exclamation point science, okay? You know, I think, you know, to me, pretty much all science is really interesting, but this is triple exclamation point science. This is really fascinating stuff. We're talking about trying to figure out 95% of the unknown nature of the universe. We're talking about repulsive gravity. All the stuff you learn, you know, kindergarten through college, throw it out the window. We're talking about gravity that doesn't attract. We're talking about anti-gravity here. And we're talking about the fate of the universe, okay? We're not talking about, you know, some, you know, small little thing. We're talking about one of the big questions. And so that's what led to part of the title. Dark energy rules the universe. It not only governs the universe through equations, but it rules. I mean, that's the big question for us all to answer. The other definition, which I didn't come up with this, I wish I did, to define dark energy is defined as the most abundant and the weirdest stuff in the universe. And that's about the most accurate definition that we have currently in science. Okay, we just really don't know what the stuff is. So one idea for what it is was actually given by Einstein 90 years ago, where he came up with something to add to the equations called the cosmological constant, which had a negative pressure, which acted in just this way. But there didn't seem to be any use for it, so people pretty much ignored it for quite a while. So why shouldn't we just bring it back and say, okay, you know, that was the answer, that's what it should be. So when you calculate how big should it be, so how big is that rocket that you're strapping onto that ball that you threw up, when you calculate that, you're off by a bit of a factor. So again, I've been talking about, you know, the students, the grads, the students, the undergraduates, and so forth. And if they turned in a homework where they were off by that much, they're probably not going to get full credit. So physicists really can't give themselves full credit for solving this puzzle either. Being modest people, they say, well, we have a fine-tuning problem. Okay, we didn't quite get it right, but give us a little bit more time. So the question really is, should we give you a little bit more time to fine-tune away some of these 120 zeros, or do you really have to look for a completely different explanation? And a lot of people are looking for a very different explanation. So again, Einstein, you know, saying, I'm not sure what you're doing is quite right here. There's in fact something that's much worse, but I'm not going to get into it. It's that it changes with time, and the cosmological constant doesn't change with time, and so we don't know how to explain that. But let me go on to some of the possible solutions to this, apart from the cosmological constant. I think those 120 zeros probably convinced you enough. So should you look for something in quantum physics to give you an answer for this strange acceleration? And people have, again, come up with ideas, what they call quintessence, is called string theory, or should you try to revamp Einstein's theory of gravitation and maybe unify it with quantum physics or look to extra dimensions, dimensions beyond the three space and one time dimension that we live in. And so the two ways I like to phrase these alternatives is, does nothing weigh something? So quantum physics, we're talking about the energy of the vacuum. You take everything out of space and time except for space and time itself. Is there still some energy there once you've removed everything? Again, it sounds paradoxical, and that's exactly why it's phrased in this paradoxical way. Does nothing weigh something? Does space and time itself have some energy associated with it? Or, from the gravitational side of things, is nowhere somewhere? You know, it's like saying, what's north of the North Pole? It's just not a question that makes sense. You might think, what's beyond the three dimensions of space that we know about? It doesn't make sense. But maybe you can come up with theories for extra dimensions. And so I phrase that as, is nowhere somewhere? And so we're trying to find out where the answer might lie To do this, we need a lot more data. So remember, we started off with the discovery from the supernova observations. We need much, much better data. Before we get back to the observations, let me quickly, again, talk about the difference between these alternatives of Einstein's cosmological constant and some of these other theories. So we're talking about space being completely filled with this cosmological constant, with this dark energy. For the cosmological constant, you can view that negative pressure. Remember, the rubber band, the springs had negative pressure. You can view space as being filled with motionless springs all the same height. They're just frozen in time. Whereas if the dark energy is dynamic, those springs could be bouncing. They could be changing their pressure over time. They could be different from one point in space to another. And so when we try to answer the questions, how much dark energy is there and how springy is it, we're really trying to find out what it is. So we discovered in 1998 that there is dark energy, but now we want to discover what makes it up, what's its nature. So I've been talking about these fields of springs, and so now we're led into quantum field theory. So I'm going to explain quantum field theory to you in one slide. And the key thing is that the word field, again, the stuff that you know about in everyday life, really is applicable. So a field, the way we use it in physics, is very much like the way we use it, a field of grass. So if we talk about a scalar field, we're talking about a quantity at each point in space. And so if you imagine a lawn, then you can say, what is the height of a blade of grass at each point in space? I'm going to measure that. For the cosmological constant, it's a perfectly mown lawn. Every blade is exactly the same height. It never changes in time. It never grows. It just always stays the same. It's astroturf or something. Okay? Whereas for a dynamical scalar field, the height of the blade of grass changes from place to place, and the grass grows or dies off and so forth. It's dynamical. And so that's the basic difference that we're trying to get to. There are other fields which we don't have to go into. Instead of the height of the blade of grass at each point, you could have the height and which direction it points. And so if you're into crop circles, someone goes around trampling down the grass, you can also ask not only the length of the blade of grass, but which direction was it trampled in. And that creates a vector field, which you might have heard about as well. So that's all that you need to know about quantum field theory. Self, as it goes out into those other dimensions. And we would see that weakening of gravity as effectively an anti-gravity force. And that could explain the acceleration of the universe if there were these other dimensions. So now you know quantum gravity. All right, let's get back to supernovae and get into the home stretch here. So what is a supernova? In particular, we're interested in one particular type of supernova. Won't go into what makes it. A supernova is basically an explosion. We see the light from that. We can measure various properties then of that light. We already talked a little bit about discovering supernova, those poor grad students down in the basement thinking they were in Hawaii and all of that sort of stuff. A popular joke among supernova observers is, how do you find a supernova? Well, you just look where the arrow points, and there's your supernova. So again, this is a Hubble Space Telescope picture of several different supernovae, and you can have slide after slide of these sort of things. As you look at more and more distant supernovae, it of course gets more and more difficult. You need better and better telescopes, and eventually you have to go to a space telescope like the Hubble. How do we use the supernova? We use them to tell us distances. Remember that tree ring picture. We want to map out the expansion of the universe as a function of distance. And again, this is similar to what you might have come across in everyday life. You can do this with lampposts. I prefer these luminarias or farolitos, which in the Southwest, around Christmas time, they put candles in these paper bags and they line the streets with them. And the idea of a standard candle or a standard light bulb is it's always giving off the same amount of light right near it. And so when you ask how much light do I receive from it, you can figure out what the distance is. Because the more distant ones are giving off light in all directions, and only a very tiny fraction comes right into your eye. Whereas from the near ones, more will come right into your eye. And so the brightness will tell you, the brightness of the supernovae, as well as the lamppost, tell you the distance away. And remember, astronomy is a time machine. Looking far into the distance is looking far into the past. So supernovae are really good objects, not just because they're so bright, but because they're so rich. And they're rich in a literal sense, and they're rich in an information sense. So in fact, all the stuff that makes us up, all the elements from carbon up, were created in supernovae. So remember, supernova give rise to those cosmic rays which give the mutations, and life on Earth evolves from that. But they also give us the basics of it. So all the heavier elements were created from supernovae. And in particular, type 1a supernova produces a lot of nickel, the metal nickel, just like in a pile of nickels. And if you can actually do the calculation and ask, well, how many nickels, how rich is a supernova literally? Well, it produces about a sixth of the mass of a sun in nickel, and at current market rates, I don't know what the market's doing today, but it comes out to some number which is, you know, unpronounceable, basically. But many, many, many dollars worth. Okay? So the heavier elements that make up us, make up the Earth, make up a lot of the structure in the universe, all came from supernova explosions. They're also very rich in that they give us a lot of information. There's a lot of ways of learning things from the supernovae. And so you can learn the energy spectrum, remember the barcode from the supermarket. You can learn how does it brighten and dim over time. And you can actually see the supernova going off in a galaxy. Okay? And from all those things, you can learn a lot, and then you can tease out the particular thing you might be interested in, how fast is the universe expanding at those various times. So again, here's this discovery picture. So I now want to bring us forward 10 years and talk about how things have improved. People have worked very hard to understand dark energy since then. So this was the picture in 1998, this ball throwing up, you throw up in the universe, and you have this curve. Astronomers like to move things around, so they actually flip this in both axes to get their plots, but don't worry about that. So now we want to jump forward 10 years and ask, how do we go from, you know, these few handfuls of data out? And so now we have many more data, and you have many more groups. So in 1998, you had two groups working on this, and now you've got about a dozen groups working on this because it's such an interesting science project. And so they also can go much further out in the universe than they could in 1998, and it matches beautifully with the curve for the particular accelerating universe. And again, this was work that was authored by a postdoc at Berkeley Lab. He's now gone on to be faculty in Berlin. You can average over these points to reduce the scatter down a little bit. And again, you can see how beautiful the agreement is so far. But we want to learn a lot more. We want to push it out further, and we want to fill this in much more densely to really understand the nature of what's going on. So again, to see the most distant ones, you have to go to space. The problem with the Hubble Space Telescope, as you saw in that movie, which ended with the Big Dipper, is it's seeing a really tiny part of the night sky. And it's such a tiny fraction, it's 1/25 millionth of the sky that we see that deeply, those 10 billion years ago, that this is like taking a single row of people here and trying to understand everything about the population of the United States just by looking at those dozen people. We obviously need something that can have a much broader view of the universe, but have the power of the space telescope. And so that's what a group at Berkeley Lab, leading an international collaboration of about 150 people, has been doing the last 10 years. Basically, right after the 1998 discovery, they said, okay, we really need much better data. We need to design a new space telescope that will let us get that broad view. So we want a very wide view. We want to go deep. We want to go this 10 billion years back. And we want to have a sort of panoramic view, both the optical, the visible, and the infrared. And the concept that they came up with, when Saul Perlmutter and Michael Levy at Berkeley Lab are the principals of this, is called SNAP, the Supernova Acceleration Probe. And this has been a very successful idea for going after the nature of dark energy. And it really excited the community, and it excited the Department of Energy, which of course runs the Berkeley Lab. And it excited NASA because it's learning about the universe. And so the two agencies agreed to do this joint mission, this joint space telescope, to learn about dark energy. And Saul couldn't be here tonight to give the talk because he's in a committee meeting talking about exactly how do you design this mission and exactly how it will be created and constructed. But we're very much hoping. The agencies have said that we should be able to launch it in about 2015 and start bringing in the data for this. So it's a bit of a while to wait, but again, we're not just sitting back and waiting for it. We're learning things with the telescopes we had, making more clever measurements and so forth. So to close up, I want to again talk about the sort of broad view of what I've been saying here tonight, that again, there's no division between the things you see in everyday life around you and the most fundamental questions of physics, the most fundamental questions of how the universe as a whole behaves. We've got some really interesting and bizarre questions, very exciting ones that we would like to answer, and we think we know about how to go forward to do it sort of step by step, each generation of experiment going forward. And so as you walk around Berkeley after this talk, and you wonder why there's a steep hill there, you wonder all sorts of questions, I hope you'll also continue to wonder about the universe and look forward, as I do, to getting the answers for this. So let's go onward to getting these answers. Thank you very much. And let me also thank all the sponsors of these Friends of Science lectures as well. So I'm happy to take some questions.
Backing up to just trying to follow your lecture, the clumping of the supernova, figuring out how far out they are, begins to let you know the shape of space, and that's what makes you think it's accelerating. How do you know if you have a bright supernova, maybe you have a little supernova? How can you tell the difference and figuring out how far away it is? You get a big lantern versus a little one.
Right. So the question was, how are we sure that the supernova are giving us an accurate picture, an accurate candle, basically? So it was like the tree ring picture that I talked about. How do you know that wasn't just a strange tree that you were looking at and there was, you know, some disease or something, and so the tree rings were not telling you about the global climate? So again, that's one of the great virtues of the supernovae, that they were so rich in information, that by looking at where the supernova is, looking at that spectrum, that barcode of the light that we were getting from the supernova, we can standardize them. We can make sure that they're each like 100-watt light bulbs, right? As you look down the street, you know, trying to find out what the distance is by the lamppost, you've got to make sure that each lamppost has the same 100-watt light bulb in it. So it's the same thing. We use the internal information from the supernovae, that question of how can we know the composition of stars. We look at the spectrum. We look at all the information that we can gather together. So it's not just, oh, there was a flash of light there. That tells us the distance. We've got to understand all the details as well. And that's where a lot of also the supercomputers come in, really making sure that we do standardize these so we can map out the history in this way. Yes?
You showed a slide that had the humps and the dips in the surface space. And it looked like you had a couple of discoveries on there that showed the humps.
So the question was, in the picture where space-time is a rubber sheet and we're dropping the bowling balls on, there were some intermediate cases where you could make the bowling balls out of different things that I didn't talk about. So again, it all comes back to that equals mc squared. If all the bowling balls have the same mass, but they have different other forms of energy in them, then they'll give different depths to the dips or different heights. And so those were some intermediate cases as you had different ratios of this sort of negative energy in addition to the mass. I only did the extremes.
You had pictures underneath the humps as if you had observed the humps.
Right, so you can't actually observe the space-time curvature in that direct way. It would be wonderful if we do. We have to infer that from the expansion history, from measuring distances to objects in the universe. Agreed with the rubber sheet idea? Right, so again, the question was, how different is this from what Einstein would have thought of? So again, it's implicit in his equation, in E equals mc squared, that every form of energy can give you a different type of gravitational attraction. And in fact, people realized already in the 1920s, they were looking more at positive forms of pressure, but they realized that if you added a positive form of pressure, you could increase the gravitational attraction. And adding a negative form of pressure could decrease it is a pretty direct consequence then as you go forward from that.
When the universe expands, is it expanding in this room or is it just like objects moving away?
Right.
Where is it expanding? Is there a new space being created?
So it's tricky using English words, using everyday language words to mean specific scientific concepts. So the question was, what do we mean by expansion of the universe? So sometimes you get tripped up when you use these everyday words and then you say, well, why isn't the podium expanding and so forth? So the idea is, when you're on very large scales, such that gravity is really the only force that you're talking about. So in the room, the chairs are held together by electromagnetism. You've got atoms, you've got protons and electrons that are keeping things together. You've got molecular bonds holding things together. So no, nothing in this room is expanding. It's completely determined by these other forces. But on the very largest scales of the universe, and you really have to go to basically the full universe, that gravity is the sole force that you're dealing with, then you get this expansion going on. And so you can't take that concept and try to bring it down to why isn't the Earth expanding or something like that. Way in the back.
Are all stars made of the same things? All expect the same, and if they're not, why are they different?
So that's a good question. So do stars all have the same barcodes? Okay, are they all cans of peas or something? And they're not. There's of course entire fields of astronomy dedicated to different types of stars. A star also evolves through its lifetime. And so you might have heard that our sun, for example, will eventually become a red giant star, and its spectrum will look very different at that point. And so that's why it's very important to get the spectrum, to get the barcode, to understand what is the properties of that particular star at that particular time. But again, you look out in the night sky, and with your eyes, you can tell that they have different barcodes, because you can see some look blue, some look white, some look red. Those all are telling you something about the composition, the temperature of the stars. that's a really good question. You know, is there a practical use for dark matter or dark energy, for example? And one of the questions is, you know, late 19th century, these physicists discovered that there was this very energetic particle that was moving around and that was fogging up their photographic film. Is there any use for that? And today, X-rays are used for all sorts of things, from biology, learning about the insides of people, to materials, learning about is there some fracture in that steel beam that's going to make it collapse at some point. So we don't know the uses until we have some time to find the thing, to experiment with it. But again, science can't be directed in that way. You can't say, okay, I want you to tell me exactly what this is good for, because it may, you know, come a very bizarre route to get to its practical use, or there may not be an earthly practical use to it.
How do you know space itself is just not spinning and causing the outward force?
So there are other measurements so the question is, how about spinning? So if you're on a merry-go-round, you feel an outward force. How do you know something like that isn't happening? So there are actually models for universes that have that. But there are also very precise measurements that can measure that sort of spin, not with supernova, but with other types of astronomical measurements. And those show that the universe as a whole, if it is spinning, must have spun much, much less than 1 degree worth of spin in its entire history. And so it's a really a negligible force.
I actually have two questions. The first is, how do you measure the absorption of cosmic rays? And the second is there any relationship between dark energy, dark matter, and black holes?
Okay, so the first question was about the cosmic rays. Yeah, so in fact, if you go to the lobby of Berkeley Lab, you'll see there's a cosmic ray detector there. There's also a very active program of reaching out to school classrooms to teach them to build their own cosmic ray detectors. And basically, these particles, as they pass through metal plates and through gases between the metal plates, cause an ionization and a little spark will go between the plates. And so you can actually visually see the cosmic ray as it passes. But again, this is there's a whole program called QuarkNet, which is designed to teach science through these sort of experiments that high schools can do. So in fact, they use a different type of particle called the muon for the pyramid things, and they put these detectors inside existing passages to see if there were other passages. The question about the black holes and dark matter and dark energy, the answer is we have no evidence for any connection between them all. They seem separate, bizarre things in the universe. Of course, there are always people who come up with ideas for how you could connect them, but there's no evidence that there is any connection for them so far.
I have two questions, too. Newton, as I understand it, thought that gravity, the effects of gravity propagated themselves instantaneously. And since Einstein's time, a lot of people held that the speed of gravity or gravitational causation or gravitational information was the same as the speed of light. So is there any thought about how the effects of quintessence or negative gravity, negative pressure, how quickly they are communicated through space and time? The other question was...
Let me start with that one. So the question had to do with does gravity propagate at the speed of light, and does dark energy move at the speed of light? So in Einstein's theory of gravity, gravitational disturbances, ripples in that rubber sheet, that space-time, do indeed propagate at the speed of light. You can come up with other theories where that doesn't hold, and then you can constrain them with observations. And there are some constraints on them, but there's also some wiggle room as well. So we don't know the definite answer. The same thing with dark energy. Specific theories make specific predictions for what the speed is. Most of them predict that the dark energy disturbances should also propagate at the speed of light. But you can come up with theories where that isn't true. And again, we'll need the observational tests in order to figure out which theory it really turns out to be.
The other question was, I've always been really struck by the beauty of the rubber sheet for explaining the distortion of space and gravity and distortion of space and time. But I realize this discomfort about it because in your analogy, you're using the result of the analogy to create the analogy. In other words, you're using gravity to a heavy object in the rubber sheet to perform the rubber sheet to explain what gravity is. So,
right. So the
physicists get around that.
Right. So the question was, how accurate is my analogy about the rubber sheet? It's meant for getting for propagating the idea out so people can understand it in a few minutes. If you spend your career, if you get a PhD in it, you can understand how mathematically they're equivalent. But the rubber sheet analogy is not perfect. It is not as accurate as actually going through all the equations are. Just like my stretching rubber band is not completely accurate as far as getting you to understand dark energy and its negative pressure. The idea is to motivate you to think about these things, to try to understand them in some way.
I was recently listening to a lecture about multiverses and the infinity of the universe, yet you started with a picture of the Big Bang and my sense of the edge to the universe. Could you just say something about this sense of infinite universe, therefore with infinite repetition of possibilities?
Right. So multiverse is a concept which currently we have no idea how to observationally test. In science, we like theories which are falsifiable. It could well be that once people have thought about it enough, they will be able to make specific predictions that can be tested. There are many instances of theories in science where people said, oh, we're never going to be able to test that, and then a few years later, people came up with tests. But right now, the idea that we're not a unique universe, there could be universes elsewhere that we don't have access to, right now, it's a concept. It's not a theory as such that we can test.
And does the idea of the Big Bang also imply, therefore, there is an edge to our universe?
No, there's a separate issue as to what's called the topology. Does the universe close off on itself or whether it's infinite? Whichever one of you wants to do it. So the question was the particle accelerator in Switzerland that recently started, the Large Hadron Collider, does this bear on these questions? So it should have a good possibility of informing us about the dark matter, the stuff that acts normally under gravity that binds galaxies together. we think that it may be possible to either create dark matter particles in it or at least give hints as to the properties of the dark matter particles. Dark energy, we don't expect there to be anything coming out of that experiment to really tell us anything specific, because again, dark energy is the smooth component. It fills the universe, and you can't localize it within the collider. And so we don't think that it's going to help us with that. But instead, these cosmological observations with this new space telescope, this joint dark energy mission, is the way to learn about that. So the question was about the tracking of the Pioneer spacecraft as it goes out into the outer solar system. There's a very, very small effect, sort of a part in a billion effect, where it's not on exactly the track that we predict from the gravity calculations. It's a very, very difficult problem because gravity is not the only force acting on the spacecraft, right? You have heating of parts of the spacecraft by the sun. You've got microparticles hitting it. Its motion is not purely from gravity, so you have to subtract off all those other effects to figure out, is there something going on with gravity? The current situation is we don't know if there is a real effect there or not. But if the effect was real, it actually has the opposite sign as what you expect from the dark energy effect. So we don't think that there is any connection. But again, most scientists aren't very sure that there is an effect there, simply because it's so difficult to make sure you've accounted for all the other effects. Okay, yes, I heard you from before.
You're talking about very, very large things. Can we go down to the very, very small things, like in quantum physics? Uh-huh. There's the concept of quantum physics where the matter does not behave normally, like, is it because of the negative energy?
Okay, so the question was, what does quantum physics have to tell us about this? What can the very small tell us about the universe as a whole? And in fact, it was only about 10 years after Einstein came up with his equations and his cosmological constant that there was the great revolution in quantum physics. And people actually understood that this vacuum energy, this quantum vacuum energy, when you are down to the very smallest features in space-time, acts as this negative pressure and can give you this cosmological constant. But again, we don't understand why the level of the cosmological constant is what it is. We had those 120 zeros that we couldn't explain. Okay, so there may be a connection, but again, we just don't know at this point. I had pointed to someone over there, or did they? No? Okay.
Is there a forum on the internet or at Berkeley Lab that civilians can attend and learn more about this and ask questions about it?
Yeah, there. Again, it's such an exciting problem that it's talked about by you know, research scientists. It's talked about, you know, general audience. So yes, there's a near infinite number of fora. If you just basically Google the words dark energy, you could, you know, add in forum or blog or news group or something. I'm sure you'll be able to get to it. I don't have any one particular one that I.
There was a picture in the New York Times about last May about dark matter and dark energy, and it had that pie chart in it. It was mm-hmm. very interesting. But there was also a picture buried in the back section that was supposedly dark matter, and just this lumpy stuff like dough. What was that a picture of?
So I don't remember the specific picture, but any such picture of dark matter or dark energy would be artist's imagination.
So we have time for two more questions.
Okay.
Back to the last question for this one. Your slide about relating all this to the microscopic, and you had string theory on there, for example, and the energy of the vacuum. And these are conundrums of quantum field theory that people are worrying about since before the discovery of the dark energy. So I'm wondering, what effect has this discovery 10 years ago had on the development of those fields?
So the question was the relation of string theory and how has that influenced. So it's very interesting, as you say, it predates the observational evidence, string theory does. And basically, up until the discovery of this, string theory said this absolutely could not exist. And now, once the observational evidence came out, string theory said, oh, of course it exists. You know, we predicted it the whole time. So string theory is not really one single theory. String theory is a vast class of theories. And so you can predict many, many different things. And the question is, how do you then test to figure out which of these many predictions? Again, a theory that predicts nothing is as bad as a theory that predicts any possibility, right? Neither one of them is testable. And so string theory is still young. We're still trying to find out how to make testable predictions with it. Yes?
If there's an accelerated expansion of the universe, then the universe's density out there should go down. Is it?
So the question was about the density of material in the universe. So even if it's not accelerating, if it's just expanding but still slowing down, the density changes. So we know that the very early universe was a very hot, dense state. We can see the remnant glow, the so-called 3-degree background glow, that George Smoot at Berkeley Lab got the Nobel Prize for seeing the tiny fluctuations in. So we know that the early universe was indeed a much hotter and denser state, and that it's been cooling and becoming less dense as time goes on. So let me thank you all again for coming out tonight.